You are watching A Close-Up Look at Animal Welfare Issues with your host, writer, speaker, and advocate, Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein. This show is supported in part by AnimalWelfareIssues.com, spotlighting issues around the globe. Check out the latest TV shows, articles, podcasts, and more. That's AnimalWelfareIssues.com. Now here's your host, Tina, in 3, 2, 1.
Good evening, I'm Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein, and thanks for watching tonight's show. As usual, you can call in at 610-378-0426 if you have any question and or comment. Over this past summer, Pennsylvania has been in the national and international spotlight, and there are two outstanding cases that have hit Pennsylvania beginning in July. And in July, a little puppy, he's actually 4 months old, a Boston Terrier, a puppy was found at a puppy mill by a produce driver. And that's the little guy up there. And this is Libre. And he actually was at death's door. And, well, he, oh my God, I forgot my train of thought. I apologize to everyone. But he was rescued, and the kennel owner did confess that this little puppy did not receive vet care. He was found in a cage, barely breathing, emaciated, dehydrated. He had a very severe case of mange, and he had open wounds with some maggots. And if it had not been for this produce driver and then the rescue that took him, this little puppy would not be alive. However, his case, Libre's case, caused an international outrage. And there's multi-layers to this story, but that's one case. And then the second case involved a horse who collapsed on a road in Lancaster County. And this horse was pulling a working cart full of watermelons. And when the horse collapsed, the owner of the horse went down to the horse to try to get it up, because once a horse collapses like that, it's next to impossible to get back up. However, he was witnessed kicking and punching this horse, and it was videotaped, and that tape was given to the police, and he was subsequently charged as well. Now, both were technically considered minor offenses according to Pennsylvania's law. And actually, the owner of this horse, he was charged with two counts of animal cruelty, and he could have had a fine of $900 each for each count, and up to $750 or $900?
$750.
Mm-hmm. And then the 90 days mm-hmm. per cruelty, per each count of cruelty. Mm-hmm. However, he only paid a small fine. So people are outraged in Pennsylvania because here are two very bad cases of animal cruelty, and the laws, they're not doing much of anything. And a third thing is the effort of fair that's coming up September 20 to the 24th. Now, for 39 years now, the effort of fair is been holding a pig chase and actually a rooster chase. The people, children and adults alike, run around an area chasing a pig, and I think typically the pig is greased up or something to make it all slippery and everything. And why is it still continuing to this day? Now, all those things are in Lancaster County, but I just want it to be said that animal abuse, it just does not happen in Lancaster County. However, my guest is involved in all three of these cases. She has firsthand knowledge of what's going on. And my guest tonight is Kristen Tullo, and she is the Pennsylvania State Director for the Humane Society of the United States, and I'd like to welcome her tonight. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Let's get right to Libre, and if you could pull up a picture of Kristen with Libre and actually Senator Richard Alloway. Mm-hmm. Do you know the current status of Libre?
So Libre is doing really great, and I think that, you know, you mentioned abuse happening all across the state. I kind of want to reiterate that as well, because neglect, abuse cases certainly happen across the state, and it happens from individual cases to operations like dogfighting and cockfighting to large-scale cruelties like animal hoarding and puppy mills. And a case like Libre's right up there, he looks incredible now. He really is a high-profile case that helps to, one, be an ambassador for the cause of animal protection issues in our state, but also, represents the hope for the many, many Libres that are still out there that we can change the law to better protect them.
The laws aren't protecting them enough. Had it not been for this produce driver who saw, I read his story, and he saw Libre, mm-hmm. and he, because the kennel owner allowed him to mm-hmm. look at them, and he saw how he had gotten worse, and the rescue that took him, and then he got around the clock care with a Dr. Pryor, who, by the way, received Veterinary of the Year Award by the Pennsylvania Veterinary Medical Association. Yep. So kudos to him and for all his hard work. But as you said, there are so many other Libres out there, and unfortunately there are puppies out there who could be dying as we speak, and no one knows about it.
Yeah.
So our laws in Pennsylvania, I mean, many animal advocates are just, they're tired of it. They want stronger laws. And the district attorney in Lancaster County, Craig Stedman, mm-hmm. And as I said, it's a multi-layered case because of the SPCA in that county not bringing any charges against this kennel owner. And they're not doing their job, and that's what the DA feels. So he has stripped them of their policing duties. They're not allowed to do that. So he has a tip line out there for Lancaster County, but he wants stronger laws.
Right.
All right. And he said regarding Libre, so cruelty of this kind should not take place in civilized society, much like criminal acts. When criminal abuse reaches a certain threshold, there must be an equally animal penalty. I mean, and we all agree, and people have wanted this, for a long time.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
In light of that, mm-hmm. tell us what you and Senator Richard Alloway are working on. If you could show the picture again of the three of them.
One of our heroes for animals, Senator Alloway. What we're describing to you, this is a multifaceted approach. The first piece is we have the legislation. So Senator Richard Alloway and the Humane Society of the United States are working on upgrading and revamping the cruelty code. And what we have recognized through the case of Libre's was a severe weakness in our cruelty code as it relates to neglect. So we're focused on better defining what neglect is, and we're also focused on upgrading animal cruelty penalties overall in the entire cruelty code. So that's the legislative end, and we are thrilled to announce that September 28th, there is a rally at noon on the Capitol steps in Harrisburg, and we are asking advocates to join us, and that's where Senator Alloway will introduce or announce his legislation, which is known as Libre's Law.
Right.
And the best news is that you can bring your dogs to the Capitol steps that day.
Fantastic, and the weather.
Yeah.
Should be good.
Yes. Yeah. And then the second piece, I definitely want to give a shout out to Pittsburgh and Philadelphia. Their cities have taken really cracked down on puppy mills by banning the sale of puppy mill dogs within their city limits and at outdoor venues. And the reason this is so important is that those are two avenues that puppy millers will really go to sell their dogs.
Right.
And so they've shut down that distribution. And just, this past summer, Council Member Kenyatta Johnson in Philadelphia had a unanimous vote, and Pittsburgh was the first city to ban this in the entire state. And Erie is doing some really progressive work around ending puppy mills in their county, and we're really hoping that they'll be the next county to have legislation or an ordinance in place like that.
Do you find, because I'm finding more townships or towns mm-hmm. and cities are passing these ordinances where you cannot sell, pet stores aren't allowed to sell these puppy mill mm-hmm. dogs. Mm-hmm. Do you see this as the future of, I don't know if altogether stopping because they still sell over the internet, but do you see this as a really good avenue to cripple this industry?
Yes, and through Pennsylvania dog law, they actually have at least one full-time person dedicated to trying to crack down on the internet sales. So I do think that is a gap, an issue that we have to figure out how to address. Absolutely.
Yes, we do.
But the more we have ordinances like that across the state, the more that pushes up at the state level to say, here's our case statement for why we need this legislation on a state level. So ordinances like anti-tethering, like the puppy mill ordinance, this is really strong case statements for us to make at the state level.
We need this so badly.
Yes.
Pennsylvania has a high number of puppy mills, mm-hmm. and I do know, a large number went underground. And I was told this by a very reputable source who said I cannot give out the person's name. But they said it since 2008 with our new dog mm-hmm. law, they went underground because they did not want to pay the price to upgrade their puppy mill. So that's been a task in itself to figure mm-hmm. out where these underground puppy mills have
yes.
gone as well.
Yep.
So
and you bring up a great point. I wanted to mention that the humane pet store conversions are also helping to complement and also showing us the trend of the future of animal protection. I mean, we have Pets Plus Natural converted all 10 of their stores to a humane model. Quakertown was the last store that they just converted, and I was at the Ben Salem event, and it was just fantastic to see that this pet store is saying, no, we're not going to take in puppy mill dogs. We're working with rescues in our area to adopt them out.
It is amazing.
It is
the
amazing.
The transformation, because the money made selling puppy mill puppies, mm-hmm. there's a lot of money to be made
right.
that way, and I think it's fantastic that they're changing the way that they're doing business. They're helping
yep.
the animals,
yep.
Instead of helping the puppy mill business. And so I think that's fantastic. I just want to get to the other case
sure.
In Lancaster County. This is all entailed together, unfortunately.
Yeah.
The horse
yes.
that collapsed
mm-hmm.
and subsequently had to be euthanized, all right? And there was outrage over this as well, and that went viral. Now, you are involved mm-hmm. with horse protection
yep.
in Pennsylvania.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so, this case represents not only the anguish that was endured by the horse, but a disturbing level of brutality, and that's what makes this case, I think, so important to the public. And when someone, a perpetrator, can beat a horse to death and receive a $750 citation, that clearly says that we need a change in our laws
right.
and the enforcement of those practices. This horse that we have, in Pennsylvania, horse protection is such a major issue because misdemeanor level offenses don't apply to horses. So,
can you explain that? Can you say it one more time?
So, misdemeanor level charges don't apply to horses. So, the maximum penalty someone in the Pennsylvania could receive for cruelty to horses, even in this egregious of a circumstance, is a fine of the $750 and up to 90 days in jail. So by raising it to a misdemeanor, we take that from the legal equivalent of a traffic citation to an actual criminal offense. And that's the importance of that misdemeanor level.
why hasn't this applied to horses?
How long
has it been this way?
So Senate Bill 294, which this is a major call to action for our advocates that are watching, it is known as Cordelia's Law. And Senator John Eichelberger is from Bedford County, and he came across a tragic situation of a horse in his district that was at an auto junkyard, and she was not able to stand on her own. She was suffering from starvation, and after intensive days of vet and foster care, couldn't be saved. So as Senator Eichelberger started looking into this, he realized this is not an isolated incident, and this is happening to horses all across the state of Pennsylvania. So he introduced the legislation, again, that would upgrade the level to a misdemeanor level charge for cruelty to horses. And this is so important to our state that our fantastic state council and district leader volunteers all chipped in money to be able to rescue a horse that was being sent to slaughter through New Holland Auction, which is a whole nother issue. But for Senator Eichelberger's bill, advocates that are watching right now, if you would go to the website, it's www.legis.state.pa.us. You can find your state representative and senator there. And this has been, it passed unanimously, the Senate. So we have no issues there. It's in House Judiciary Committee, and it's been there for over a year. We need all advocates to contact their state representative and tell them to enact Cordelia's Law immediately so this doesn't continue happening to horses in our state.
If somebody wants more information about Cordelia's Law so they know what they're talking about, where can they find that so they know when they're talking to their legislator?
Sure. So we put out the best place for our action alerts are to sign up to be an HSUS ally. Mm-hmm. And we send alerts through there. And we also, our Facebook page, the HSUS-Pennsylvania. So those are the best avenues for priority legislative items that we're trying to get across the finish line.
Okay. And tell us about your mascot, and if you could show that picture of Kristen and the horse.
Whenever I see Penn, I'll have a really big smile. So Penn is named after William Penn of Pennsylvania, and one of my heroes for animals is Kelly Smith with Omega Horse Rescue. So probably one of the hardest days I've had in my career in animal protection was going to New Holland to see the horse auction. And
I've never been there, but I know.
You know, Penn here was a racing horse that made a lot of money for somebody who, when they were done with them, sold them to an Amish farmer that the horse then became a working horse. And when they were done with them,
just commonplace.
This is very common. And these horses get caught up in this cycle, and then the next thing you know, they're at New Holland being loaded up on a slaughter truck to be taken to Canada, where they're slaughtered there. So we rescued Penn from, he was literally being loaded up. Now, Penn represents, there are hundreds of horses every week that are being loaded up to go to slaughter. So a federal call to action is the SAFE Act. It's the Safeguard American Food Exports Act. Senator Casey and Senator Toomey, our two U.S. senators, have not signed on as co-sponsors. So we would love, it's an action alert if you just look Humane Action SAFE, S-A-F-E, Act, the Humane Society of the United States. You can literally go on there and send the note right from that website, asking them to co-sponsor this legislation that would make the transport of horses for slaughter illegal, but it would also defund slaughter facilities from opening in our country, which would be terrible.
Yeah, and I don't think people do understand that racing horses, winning racing horses, they end up at slaughter.
Yep.
You know, and I don't think people realize that. I mean, you know, they're in all their glory and their lives have to end like that. Or many times, I mean, they do become workhorses as well. Mm-hmm. And that's people don't understand that, you know, that, you know, are betting on these race horses, but they don't know the story behind what's really happening to the horses, you know. And when I see it on television, you know, glorifying, you know, these horse races, and like, let's tell the other side about, you know, what's happening to them. It's like, you're talking about this horse winning big and everything, and and the jockey, and then they get all this media attention. But it's like, this is the horrible side. And the other side, you know, to all of this. Mm-hmm. So, in Pennsylvania, though, let me see if I get this right. Pennsylvania does not have a felony cruelty statute.
Correct.
Even though people are under the assumption that all 50 states, they're saying that animal cruelty is a felony in all 50 states.
For animal fighting. Yes.
For animal
fighting. For animal fighting, for dog fighting and cock fighting. We do not.
So this is misinformation that's put out there. Because everybody assumes, because I've shared it with people, that it isn't.
Right. Yeah. So we, and with Libre's law, we are only one of three states, by the way, that currently do not have a felony charge for animal cruelty for torture situations, which would be, you know, dismembering and, you know, beating, severe cases of cruelty that we would want to prosecute at a felony level. So Mississippi and
Iowa
are the only other two states. So really with this, we're just aligning with the rest of the country. And, you know, so that's
so
really
overdue here in Pennsylvania.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we need to get on this. And we have a few more minutes, but I want to quickly get this in. Effort Affair with their pig chase.
Yes.
Okay. Tell the people. I mean, how can you explain it in 30 seconds or less? You know, people are...
Yeah.
What some people enjoy doing.
So cruel practice that, you know, teaching our children respect for animals, not animal cruelty, is what's going on in these events. We should be teaching our children kindness and compassion. And these events.
Don't you think that's where it starts? Getting them really early and teaching them.
Absolutely, planting the seeds. And, you know, so I think with this situation, I mean, if you hear the videos and hear the pigs crying, they're not running because they're excited and playing with you.
That's what they say. They squeal. All pigs squeal. You know, it's just part of their nature. So they're not being hurt.
They
enjoy it.
And they are fighting fear of their lives. That's why they're running. And we want a kind and compassionate Pennsylvania. And that starts with our local communities and seeing District Attorney Craig Stedman enact the cruelty tip line and reach out to the HSUS and partner organizations in the state to deliver animal cruelty training for law enforcement. It's trending in that direction. So we're just asking that the fair cancel that event this year. There's, I believe, rooster chasing too.
Yes.
So,
last year it was canceled, and it's still scheduled as of this year. And I think, from what I read, now we don't know if that's always accurate, but the adult section of the pig chase has been cut out.
That's correct.
It is. Okay.
But, you know, the 12 to 15 year old range.
I only know that.
It's just so critical. That we get them at that age, what you said beautifully, was where we need to start. And I think that the, you know, a great call to action for this is to write the council members, of the fair council members, and actually they can be found on a website. If you just Google the fair officers, literally you can find their information.
Yes.
And also the township, contact the town and say, we don't want this in our community. There's alternatives. A parish in Wisconsin just announced that they are doing, in place of the pig contest,
they just got canceled
theirs. Foosball with pig-sized balls. Like, they're doing a different, you know, differently and the compassionate way.
And I just saw a thing. It's a pig chase. However, it's a virtual thing where pigs are in front of a screen, and on your computer, you actually can create this, like, it's not a dot, it's larger than that, but the pigs will chase that. I mean, this is all humane. I mean, you're not chasing anything. It's just through the computer, and they see it come up on a screen, just like a red light with a cat. And that's what they're doing, is that it's on a wall, and the pigs can go after them. So it's like, you know, this is not hurting any pigs. But I don't understand that why anyone would want to be involved in a pig chase. You know, I personally don't understand the mindset, and I've read about people who do get involved and they look forward to it. They say it's lots of fun, and their parents say their children are looking forward to it. Now, some places have canceled theirs. There's another state where they canceled it this year.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think it's hopefully, you know, it can slowly become a thing of the past.
Right.
So, we have a minute left. So, what do you tell anyone about? I mean, there's so much animal abuse going on, but what can we do? Do we contact our legislators?
Yes.
I mean, what are the big things that we can do?
So building relationships with your legislators is key.
And should they be afraid to call?
Absolutely not. They are, that is the most powerful tool that we have as advocates, is picking up the phone and calling.
And we vote them in, so they're working.
Right.
You shouldn't be afraid to call them.
No, and if you have 10 people that you can get together in your district and meet with your state senator or state representative and just get together for coffee and talk about the fact that you vote and you care about animal protection, that is the biggest thing that advocates can do to make long-term sustainable change for animals.
And people can also go to your website?
Absolutely. Yes, the HSUS/Pennsylvania. And we, just kind of to recap the action alerts, you know, we are hoping, you know, that people would contact their representative about Cordelia's Law. So that's your state representative contacting your U.S. senators about the SAFE Act. And with the pig chase, contacting the Fair Council and the Town Council. And Libre's Law, join us September 28th.
Yes, I wanted to reiterate that September 28th. What time is it?
Noon, Capitol Steps.
And you can bring your pet. So I want to thank Kristen for joining me this evening. It's been a great pleasure. Love to have you back on again.
Thank you
so
much.
The time flies. If you check out my website at animalwelfareissues.com, I will have this show up there in about a day. So thank you for joining us this evening, and save a life and adopt.